Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few.
Good night, boys.
This is the BBC Light Program.
The 40s was a decade driven by conflict. The war against Germany may have terrified the nation, but it also gave it a new solidarity. To the music of Vera Lynn and Glenn Miller, people from different political and economic backgrounds worked together in armaments factories, on the land and in hospitals to beat a common enemy. But even as Hitler and fascism were defeated, a new threat to world peace emerged. Russia the ally became Russia the Cold War enemy. And, almost before the dust of the Nagasaki bomb had settled, an iron curtain was descending across Europe. National boundaries were redrawn to accommodate Stalin's post-war territorial demands. American foreign policy, isolationist for so many years, shifted to block Russian expansionism. In 1949, NATO and the world of superpowers was born.
I thank you.
Post-war, the resurrected television service struggled to make programmes with no money of its own. The BBC hierarchy was reluctant to increase spending on the newfangled medium of television, which it was feared would encourage passivity and lead to a surfeit of entertainment.
The dress came out of a fairy tale.
Everybody. How are you? Do you remember me? Jeff and Brian. Well, here we are after a lapse of nearly 7 years, ready to start again. And of course, we're always terribly excited and thrilled that the great day has at last arrived when this station is once more ready to go on the air. Artists, cameramen, producers, scene men, and all sorts of people are here ready to make this afternoon's program.
Hey, what's wrong?
Send the women away, but keep the men.
See.
We have to take machine guns and scorch it down and get Spike O'Hara.
But look, Tony.
He turned yellow. Put the men downstairs to watch for him and give me the signal. If he comes here, I'll fix him.
Most beautiful dress. Essentially, it's a very modern one, and yet it has a feeling of the past to it and an almost ethereal quality. It's of ivory white satin, and the whole dress is most delicately embroidered with seed pearls and crystals and garlands of white York roses entwined with ears of corn. The whole effect really looks as if the dress came out of a fairy tale.
I can look on at the great man business. I assure you that all the fun of that business is yours. It's the people who celebrate me who have the fun. But I have all the hard work.
Slow, slow, quick, quick, slow.
Another program from the Television Dancing Club.
The Royal Navy is in the center of the picture now. The high-ranking officers of the Royal Navy and Royal Marines, the captain of the Royal Navy and commander of the Royal Navy, the seamen, the color parties, other seamen, the Royal Navy band. We'll see that in a minute. But now here are the lads in blue. Marching as only they can march.
During the war, BBC Radio became the nation's source of truth and reassurance, inextricably woven into the fabric of people's lives. Outside Britain, the BBC was the world's unrivaled broadcaster. Post-war, radio's preeminence and its financial security seemed assured.
Dick Button, Special Agent.
D-Day has come.
Ladies and gentlemen, we invite you to have a go.
Can I do you now, sir?
Oh, hello.
This is the national programme from London. The first news, copyright reserved. The evacuation of British children is going on smoothly and efficiently. Railways, the road transport organisations, the local authorities and teachers, the voluntary workers, and not least, the householders in the reception areas, are all playing their parts splendidly.
Don't get worried about us. We're all very happy here. And I don't think anybody wants to go home yet. We go on the moors nearly every night and watch all the cows and the sheep grazing and the river flowing. We're quite near it now. And we go playing football on the football pitch and watch the colliery. Last week, the boys and girls had a match of netball. And there was 14 girls and three boys, but the girls won us.
Thousands of you in this country have had to leave your homes and be separated from your fathers and mothers. My sister, Margaret Rose, and I feel so much for you, as we know from experience what it means to be away from those we love most of all. To you, living in new surroundings, we send a message of true sympathy. And at the same time, we would like to thank the kind people who have welcomed you to their homes in the country.
Having received His Majesty's commission, I have formed an administration of men and women of every party and of almost every point of view. We have differed and quarreled in the past, but now one bond unites us all: to wage war until victory is won, and never to surrender ourselves to servitude and shame, whatever the cost and the agony may be.
This is the BBC Home and Forces programme. Here is the news, and this is Bruce Belfridge reading it. There is an Admiralty communique giving the full story of recent naval successes in the Mediterranean. Besides the latest details of RAF successes against Berlin and other vital objectives, there is more news of the good results of our air raids in Africa. More daylight air attacks by enemy fighters have been broken up. There is comment both from Moscow and London on the news from Romania. Tonight's talk after this bulletin will be by Lord Lloyd, the Colonial Secretary. The story of recent naval successes in the Mediterranean is told in an Admiralty communique issued tonight.
But here at Dunkirk is another English epic. And to my mind, what was most characteristically English about it? So typical of us, so absurd and yet so grand and gallant that you hardly know whether to laugh or to cry when you read about them, was the part played in the difficult and dangerous embarkation by the little pleasure steamers. We've known them and laughed at them, these fussy little steamers, all our lives. Sometimes they only went as far as the next seaside resort, but the boldest of them might manage a channel crossing to let everybody have a glimpse of Boulogne. But they were called out of that world, and let it be noted, they were called out in good time and good order, to sail into the inferno, to defy bombs, shells, magnetic mines, torpedoes, machine gun fire, to rescue our soldiers.
This is the BBC Home and Forces programme. Here's the news. This is Wilfred Pickles reading it. This morning's news of Japan's aggression is of successful countermeasures against the invasion of Malaya. There have also been reports of enemy attacks on Thailand and Hong Kong. At Shanghai, the Japanese have taken over the international waterfront and sunk the British gunboat Petrel. President Roosevelt has spoken of serious damage and casualties in the earlier Japanese air raids on America's Pacific naval bases, and the Japanese are reported to have lost an aircraft carrier and some of their bombers and submarines.
He is dying. I could not believe it, but he is dying.
It grows darker and darker. All the people are drifting away. Soon there will be only the soldiers and ourselves. When everything else has perished, love and duty still keep watch.
She'll be here tonight. Good gracious, what shall I get for her supper?
You ain't making a fuss over Maria. Let her have what we have. Be thankful to get it. Oh, Grandma, the poor old girl will miss her midday meal. And she's bringing her bit of meat with her.
Oh, is she? Oh. Oh, well, it's only what you ought to do. We shall have to stretch her bit of meat a good deal to make it do for three.
I know. I'll make a Connaught pie.
Another disguise for parsnips.
You'll hear from me again next week. Good night, boys. Sincerely yours, Vera Lynn.
We'll meet again. Don't know where. Don't know where.
Ladies and gentlemen, workers, playtime!
broadcast as usual from a large wartime factory canteen before a crowd of Britain's men and women victory workers. We're calling all workers in this country and in all the Allied nations. Here's to you, and here is your show.
Some will be irritated, many will be exhilarated, everybody will be methylated to hear that it's that man again.
It's that man again, it's that man again, yes, the Tommy Handley is here.
When spirits flag from out of the bag, he'll extricate a time-honored gag.
Father Time and Boy, Mrs. Handley Boy, oh, it's useless to complain. When trouble's brewing, it's his doing, and that man again.
Hello?
Is Mr. Handley there?
No, ma'am, I ain't seen him in days.
How many days is he in for?
Madam, we are not amused.
Well, tell him Miss Stropper phoned, will you?
Yes, ma'am.
And watch his face fall.
Gee, this don't sound too good for the boss. I wonder where he is.
He won't be long now. I've just greased the steps.
Hello, Sam. I've just fallen for a girl on the stairs. How are you?
But how are you today? How's your tongue? Is it smooth and red, or knobby and beige with an overcoat of a muddy hue? And how's the stomach? Is it firm and steady, or somewhat warm, or a little wobbly and a trifle windy? Or was your Christmas day so Spartan that today you're fighting fit with no twinge of remorse?
The living lay with their heads against the corpses, and around them moved the awful ghostly procession of emaciated, aimless people, with nothing to do and no hope of life, unable to move out of your way, unable to look at the terrible sights around them. There was no privacy, nor did men or women ask it any longer. Women stood and squatted, stark naked in the dust, trying to wash themselves and to catch the lice on their bodies. Babies had been born here, tiny, wizened things that could not live. A mother, driven mad, screamed at a British sentry to give her milk for her child, and thrust the tiny mite into his arms and ran off, crying terribly. He opened the bundle and found the baby had been dead for days.
Browning's poem ends with a challenge blown on a trumpet. And yet, dauntless the slughorn to my lips I set and blew. While Roland to the dark tower came. Note well the words, and yet. Roland did not have to, he did not wish to, and yet in the end he came to the dark tower.
Now, that's the challenge. And mark this, always hold the note at the end.
Yes, Sergeant Trumpeter, yes. Why need Gavin hold the note at the end?
Mark, you're too young to know. It's all tradition.
Well, what's tradition, Sergeant Major? Ask Mother that one. She knows.
Aye, she knows. But run along, sonny. Leave your brother to practice. No, again. That's it now. But hold that last note. Hold it.
The program is about to begin. We are rehearsing the opening announcement. The last details are being added. In the studio, last directions from the producer. The producer is speaking.
And rather quicker on cues in those quotation lines, everybody.
Last detail.
We can expect to pick up 10 seconds. Oh, yes, thanks. Charles, you missed that light on page 12. There was a muddle.
Yes, I know I did. I'm very sorry, but I didn't know that line was cut.
Yeah, the whole line's out.
Yes, I know. Entirely my fault.
No, my fault.
Oh, no, my fault.
Yes, my fault. 1 minute to go. You'll go ahead on a green light then, Pat. Right.
One minute to go. We can hear now the music of the program before. The producer hands over to the actors and to the engineers. Less than a minute to go now. All the work in the writing and the rehearsing of the program, all now coming to a head, all boiling down to this one supreme moment.
Dick Barton, Special Agent. Dick Barton and his friends suspect that the Coastal Queen, which has requested permission to put in at London docks with engine trouble, is connected in some way with Betts and Hartman. While Inspector Burke is contacting the War Office regarding Betts' plan to poison reservoirs, Dick, Snow and Jock set out in a motor launch to meet the Coastal Queen.
Here they come now, round the last bend, coming up to the finishing. We can see the bridge ahead of us, about 150 yards to go, 250, 200 yards to go. Oxford caps waving in the air, Cambridge caps waving in the air. Oxford leading, Oxford about, I think, 5 or 6 feet ahead. That's about all. They're coming up now. They're both crews ripping up the stroke and coming into rail fighting finish. They're both crews obviously had the most grueling race, one of the greatest races that had ever been, ever boat races ever had, and the perfect conditions too. Oxford in the lead, I think. I don't know, but I think it's almost neck and neck. It's level, I should think. I'm not quite sure. It must be level. Cambridge picking up the stroke. I think Cambridge are ahead. I don't know who's ahead. It's either Oxford or Cambridge. It's neck and neck the whole way over. There's about less than 100 yards to go.
Ladies and gentlemen, we invite you to have a go.
Pickles. Ladies and gentlemen of Ramsbottom, I do. How are you?
Practically the whole of London.
Hello, BBC, this is Frank Gillard here, recording just outside Chile, a mile or two back from Chile, on Friday morning, June the 16th, during a barrage which is being laid down to prepare the way for an infantry attack on a small village just to the east of Chile.
Finally, the British, bringing up the rear of this vast procession as hosts at London 1948.
Good night.
Never.
Here is the news, and this is Bruce Belfridge reading it.
Here is the midnight news, and this is Alvar Liddell reading it. Up to 10 o'clock, 175 German aircraft had been destroyed in today's raids over this country. Today was the most costly for the German Air Force for nearly a month.
All through the day, the program worked almost to the minute, and at the agreed time, re-embarkation began. The tanks which had to be left were blown up and the men were taken off in small craft. The Navy stayed until the very last minute, and at the very end, a destroyer went in and engaged the shore defenses with her guns, while smaller craft brought off several hundred more men. It's good to be able to say that far more men were brought away than those who planned the operation had ever expected.
No. Good night, boys.
What?
The 40s was a decade driven by the four.
Never.
Good night, boys.
The 50s was the decade of the Korean War and the Suez Crisis. It was the decade when McCarthy's witch hunt against communist sympathizers struck fear in the hearts of Americans. Growing mutual distrust between East and West produced a rash of spies, Burgess and MacLean, Philby, the Rosenbergs. But it was also a decade of conquest, Everest, space, and the four-minute mile. In an age of consumerism, austerity became a thing of the past. Teenagers and pop music were new concepts that went hand in hand. Marilyn Monroe, James Dean, and Elvis Presley were the new icons. People had money in their pockets. The man in the street was becoming part of the affluent society. Million people watched Elizabeth II's coronation. Many homes owned a television, and the Radio Times was the world's best-selling weekly. The advent of commercial television brought added choice. Viewers had never had it so good.
Yes, it's Cracker Jack.
Ah, good evening, all.
shoulder down, stay up on your toes, arms right up high. Now drop your heels. Take your arms down. If you want to pull your jersey down, pull it down.
Good afternoon and welcome once again to our gardening club.
What are you doing to that pillar box?
Oh, just leaning, you know, leaning.
Do you always lean with your hand inside the box?
No, I...
Now, are you Irish?
No, of course I'm not.
What are you trying to put in that box in?
Nothing.
I see. Then you must be trying to get something out.
Isn't that brilliant? You're wasted on this beat, really, aren't you? You ought to be down at Doc Green. Of course I'm trying to get something out of me hand.
In the news, a fortnightly discussion among speakers of different political views on topics in the news.
I have the greatest respect for the BBC, our employer, on this occasion. We have to mark our words very carefully. But nevertheless, there is nothing more boring than a news bulletin on the BBC unless there happens to be a world war raging at the time.
You've no idea how we live. I fancy five of us in one bed. Five of us. I mean, Mother used to be trying to cover us, you know. And she'd have our coats on us, you know. And the nightmen had come and knock at the door. And if that man found three of us in that bed, my mother would force the coat and find 5 shillings.
Here is an illustrated summary of the news. It'll be followed by the latest film of events and happenings at home and abroad.
The truce talks in Indochina went on today.
Well, then, who says anything?
You do, sir.
What?
You yeah. Do. From the moment the socialists got into power in 1945, prices started rising.
Have you said that?
No, you said that.
It has often been said in recent times that the Conservative Party is a warmongering party. Is there a shred of truth in that, or is there?
I must say, I do resent that question. I could resent it very much.
Discharged from an asteroid near the Earth, aminid creatures are growing to monstrous size and power at the first of the steel pressure domes at Winnenden Flats. Discovery that the purpose of the vast secret plant, planned by infected human beings, is to harbor the aminids in the recreated conditions of an outer planet, leads to an armed riot by uninfected construction workers.
Hi there. I'd like to introduce you to Saskatchewan. This, in case you haven't met before, is the province of Saskatchewan, square in the heart of Canada.
The last 2 weeks of March are an anxious time for the spaghetti farmer. There's always the chance of a late frost, which, while not entirely ruining the crop, generally impairs the flavor and makes it difficult for him to obtain top prices in world markets.
The tape is broken, and so is the record athletes have long been dreaming about.
Only one thing now can save the reputation and the honor of our country. Parliament must repudiate the government's policy. The Prime Minister must resign.
Am I right in saying that what is on the card is not just postage?
No, you're not. We walked into that one. There we are. Never mind. That's the best bit of bluff we've done on this side of the house yet. Got you right off postman. Oh, wonderful. You've beaten the expert.
I can see there, and you may be able to see there, just by the surgeon's forceps, the hole between the two chambers. There it is. The surgeon's just put it, he's examining it carefully now. He's just put a forceps towards it to identify the size of it.
The television boom meant that radio was relegated to a supporting role. Audiences declined hugely as commercial competition won their affections. The BBC was prepared to fight hard, however, and the growth of VHF broadcasting led to an extension of the regional network.
Are you sitting comfortably? Then I'll begin.
Good morning, schools.
You, Christy?
It is, ma'am.
I thought the hinny was familiar. How's your good wife?
No better, ma'am.
Your daughter, then?
No worse, ma'am.
Why do you halt? But why do I halt?
Watch her, Grace. She's terrified.
Oh, my God, this is ghastly. Get out of it, quickly.
This is Isabella and Judy in those boxes at the end.
Yes, all right, but you get out, Grace. Go on, get out.
Look, can you take the pony?
Yes, I'll try. Come on, steady, Judy, steady. It's all right, old girl.
Oh, part of the ceiling fallen. It started the straw in the boxes near the door. We'll have a hell of a job getting the horses past.
Well, drive them. Come on, get up. Go on, stupid, move.
Stand clear, Grace. We're coming out in a rush.
Come on, Judy.
Sling your coat over her head. Now, come on.
All out now.
Yes, take these two. Okay, I've got Judy.
I've got the other.
It's an inferno in there. Place must be as dry as a tinder. Come on, get well away.
Inside!
My gosh, we're lucky to get him out.
Yes, certainly were.
What's up?
Midnight couldn't have been tidier. Look, she's going back into the stable.
What?
No, Grace! No, don't do it!
She's going in after midnight. Grace!
Grace! For God's sake, Grace, come back!
This is the BBC.
Yeah, I'll bet you can't say that without moving your lips.
Why on earth should I?
Because it's clever. Haven't you ever heard those ventriloquists? They do it all the time. Go on, have a go.
No, I don't want to.
Oh, go on, don't be bashful. There's nobody listening.
No.
Oh, go on, Archie.
No, go away and leave me alone.
Oh, correct me if I'm wrong, but do I detect a slight cooling off in your attitude towards me?
Yes.
Well, why?
Well, if you must know, I find you uncouth, ill-mannered, coarse, brash, unkempt, shabby, vulgar. And amongst my intellectual circle of friends, you would appear an oaf, a bore, and a lout.
Oh, well, as long as it's nothing personal. Well, go on then, announce the programme.
Thank you very much. Well, I mean, I'm sure you're quite finished. You don't mind if I carry on.
My friends, I
ladies and gentlemen, whatever happens during the next 30 minutes will certainly be beyond our ken.
Desert Island Discs. Each week, a well-known person is asked the question, if you were to be cast away alone on a desert island, which 8 gramophone records would you choose to have with you? As usual, the castaway is introduced by Roy Plumley.
How do you do, ladies and gentlemen? Our castaway this week is an actor and director who's very distinguished.
The time in Britain is 12 noon, in Germany it's 1 p.m., but at home and away, once again, it's time for two-way family favourites.
It is very simple, this lying in state of a dead king, and of incomparable beauty. High above, all light and shadow and rich in carving, is the massive roof of chestnut that Richard II put over the great hall. From that roof, the light slants down in clear, straight beams, unclouded by any dust, and gathers in a pool at one place. There lies the coffin of the king. The oak of Sandringham, hidden beneath the rich golden folds of the standard. The slow flicker of the candles touches gently the gems of the imperial crown.
Look at that. What? I can't say goodbye.
It's a police inspector standing in a tobacconist's window with a postcard pinned to him. What does it say?
Amateur photographer needs a beautiful model.
Not that police inspector. The one next to him.
Ah! £1 in cash or sterling offered for the body of a murder victim.
Well read, Moriarty. We are about to cop some lob.
But where can we get the body?
Quick, stick this imitation bullet hole on your forehead. Right. Fall down in the gutter and close your eyes.
Ah! I say, Mr. Little Round Copper.
What?
May I introduce you to the body of Count Jim Toes of Moriarty? Only man to have shot a telephone directory in flight and twice world cheese dancer.
I'll take him.
I thank you.
Now, why is this body lying down?
He's been murdered.
Badly?
No, very well. He's dead.
It's all over him. What? A fake bullet hole? What does this mean?
He was murdered by a fake bullet.
Gad, what a hellish way to die.
Thank you.
La da 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 dee 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 da 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 dee 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 da 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 dee. I'll be with you all again tomorrow morning. La da dee 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 da.
Journey into space. The BBC presents Jet Morgan in The World in Peril. April 15th, 1972, Earth time. The Mars fleet, or what is left of it, is returning to the moon nearly a year before its scheduled time.
The time comes quite soon as you leave Korea behind when you ask yourself, just how ironic can things become? Here you have a country that those perverse, poetic Asiatics call the land of the morning calm. Of all places on earth, the most disrupted and chaotic. You have months of defeat and failure changed overnight into a sort of triumph. You have a moment of victory developing to something that increases the tension with every step nearer peace. You have military conquest marching hand in hand with political despair, great and powerful figures growing feet of clay, and little insignificant men turning into heroes of a kind. Even now, with the story pushed only a few days into my own personal past, I find it hard to believe that right now, 8 or 9,000 miles away, there's a country just about the size of England where men and women are exulting and mourning and flinching and hiding, just as the other day I was exulting and mourning and flinching and hiding and trying to remember what life used to be like in the days before Korea. When there was beer to be bought and beds to be slept in and nothing went bang in the night.
This is the BBC Home Service for Schools. Time and tune. Here is Kay Foster.
Good morning, schools. We'll begin with the song, There Was an Old Woman. So find page 2 quickly. Page 2. There was an old woman. John Camburn is here today to sing with us. Let's sing the song straight through first, singing both the verses. Here's the note to begin, and I'll count 2 before we start. You ready? 1, 2.
There was an old woman lived under the stairs. Hee-ho.
Come on, Ron. It's your dad. You're all right, Ron. Come on, there's nothing wrong with you.
Try forcing his head between his knees.
Righto, Ed.
Oh, no, not that way, Mr. Clark. Forwards.
Oh, forwards. Just leave it to me. Come on, Ron, you'll be all right.
He's coming round. Now then, give me that water off there, Ed.
Oh, but Mr. Clump...
Get it, Ed, and give it here. Now then, boy, sip this. Sip it gently. Mm. Sip it, lad. Gently, gently, gently. You gulp like that and you'll swallow the goldfish.
Oh, my head. Where am I? Oh.
You're all right, beloved? You've had a bit of a knock on the head.
Who are you?
Syrup is sold in the post office. A car drives to market, full of fowls and a farmer. Milk churns stand at Coronation Corner like short, silver policemen. And sitting at the open window of Schooner House, blind Captain Cat hears all the mourning of the town.
Come on, Ricky, we believe. Maggie Richards.
Wait a minute, I lost my compass.
Ricky Reyes? Tommy Powell?
Now,
Sal. Little Getaway? Billy Swansea with a dog's voice? One of Mr. Waldo? Nasty Humphrey? Jackie with a sniff? Where's Dickie Zanby and the boy from Tea Pant? Or perhaps they got the rats again. Somebody's hit Maggie Richards. 2-1 is Billy Swansea. Never trust a boy who barks. Right again, it's Billy.
And the children's voices cry away.
The 50s was the decade.
Vera, the Vision Electronic Recorder.